Up next on American Restoration.
There it is.
Oh, wow.
I'm here to talk to Rick about my 1930s photo booth that I'd like to have restored.
It is so awesome.
It may be one of only five like this left in the world.
Wow.
This is it. This is the Rose Bowl, baby.
I brought Tyler and Bradley out to the Rose Bowl to experience the granddaddy of all flea markets.
You got the money. Ron's brought me to a lot of cool places for picking, but this is by far the coolest place he's ever taken me. This is basically the holy grail of photo booths. If you have this, you're the bomb.
You're the bomb.
You're the bomb. Only one big problem. It's a technology that just doesn't exist anymore.
Look at a man's workbench. You see his passions. His work's in progress. The things that drive him crazy. Projects that? You get the point. Anyway, every workbench tells a story. And this is ours. American Restoration.
Hey, you guys about ready to get out of here?
Yep.
Hell yes.
All right.
This is really exciting. I'm sending Ron and the boys out to the Rose Bowl Flea Market in Pasadena, California. This place is so cool. A great football venue turns into one of the largest marketplaces in the U.S. I actually got my business started at the Rose Bowl. I sold my first Coke machine there. Boy, have we came a long way.
It's a big deal for the company. It's like a show. There's an area all the way around the football field where you're trying to sell stuff and pick some good picks. Are you coming with us? I'm not going. Somebody's got to hold down the fort. So you guys go.
We packed up several Coke machines, a slot machine, and even a barber chair to take out there with us. If it's anything like it was 30 years ago, we should have no problem selling something.
Hurry it up. Get down there.
See you later.
All right, you too. Remember, what happens on the road
stays on the road.
Take it into Kyle and get that thing put on there first.
Okay.
You'll go in here and get it.
You got someone backing up.
Having just sent three of my guys on the road, it's pretty damn typical that a giant truck is backing in my shop when I'm short-handed.
There it is. That is a 1930s photo booth.
Oh, wow. That's cool. Let's get it out. Can we get it out?
Sure. I'm here to talk to Rick about my photo booth that I'd like to have restored.
Oh, my God. This is...
Careful.
Yeah!
This guy had it in his garage, and I took it from him for $150. And I want to see if Rick can bring it back to life.
Woo!
The beauty, huh?
Wow. It is so awesome. I've never seen a steel one.
Yep. It's all metal. This was made by Mutoscope out of New York back in the 30s. From what I've researched and what I've found out, it may be one of only five like this left in the world.
Wow.
Yeah. So it's quite rare.
I mean, it's beautiful. I mean, this was a bus stop, train station, world fairs.
Right.
And right after World War II, the owner of the company died. The company went bankrupt in about a week.
Wow.
So I'm trying to teach my son to try to pick up after me because since I died, this thing's done too.
I found actually some pictures of it if you want to take a look.
Photomatic.
So what's unique about this booth was that it didn't print out a strip of three. It printed out individual pictures. It doesn't have a photo on it anymore, but...
So that's basically what's in here. A little metal frame, and it actually... put the picture right on the front.
Yeah, it came out fully framed like that.
It's incredible. The Polaroid camera was a genius move. This was 10 times that. That's incredible stuff.
This thing is absolutely amazing. Not only was it essentially a dark room in a box, but it framed every picture it spit out. I mean, I thought the ones from today were cool, but this is a real feat of engineering.
So we're going to restore this to look like it did in the day.
Well, what I would like to see is as much of its unique originality as possible. I've been a photographer since I was 9 years old.
Oh, wow.
And the one thing about the old photo booths is because they worked with chemistry, the chemistry would corrode all the parts on the inside.
And they're trash.
And they're trash.
Of the five that we know that are in existence, including this one, none of them have working parts.
Oh, yeah? I mean, my objective is to make it do what it did.
Amazing.
So I will definitely try to research this, you know, maybe above and beyond. I don't know what I can come up with.
Uh-huh. It's hard to say what it's going to take to get this thing working again, but I really want to take on the challenge, even if it means getting an expert here to help me figure this thing out.
All right, so to do the whole thing up, I'm right around 11 to 12 grand.
Well, I haven't had it sitting around for 20-some-odd years for nothing.
Nothing.
So let's do it.
All right, awesome, awesome. I can't wait to do this.
I'm really hoping that Rick can get the photo part to work, but I can't wait to see what this looks like when it's done.
So we're here. This is it. This is the Rose Bowl, baby. We're hanging out. We're doing stuff. People are literally going to come into our booth.
Yeah.
Look, touch, feel.
We're here today at the Rose Bowl, the granddaddy of all flea markets. Tyler and Bradley are with me. I'm excited to show them the ropes.
I'm psyched, dude. Start walking around and seeing all the cool stuff. Just imagine the things people have.
Trust me.
I want to get out there, too. I want to go look. But we got to sell some machines, man. We got to do some sales.
I can do it. You guys can go out.
Do you think you know these machines?
I got this.
What do you think?
I'm good with it.
So Bradley offers to watch the booth. You know, I love his enthusiasm, but the kid has never sold a machine in his life. So this could get a little sketchy.
You got this?
Yep.
Okay.
All right.
I'm out.
So I feel a lot of pressure on me, you know, but I'm going to do whatever it takes to get it done. It's a good first time for me. Got barber's chair here for sale. Looks pretty nice, huh?
Dude, there's seriously cool stuff here.
This place is awesome. Yeah. Being here in the kind of swap meet environment, it really makes me understand where my dad came from, so it's really cool.
Dude, look at this, Rod. This thing's badass.
Dude, look, it's like, it must have been like an addition to a pedal car or something. It's a Murray. Can you imagine riding around on a pedal car back in the day and having this behind you?
Because you're on your tractor, you got something in it.
Yeah, that's so cool.
That is cool.
I mean, the graphics, you can tell that they're great. That's like really cool. Like, I'm really mesmerized.
$50 and it's yours.
$50?
We'll even deliver it down to your vehicle.
Yeah.
Oh, bonus.
You got the money. After I ended up talking to the guy, he wanted to sell it for $50, which I feel was like a steal. Dude, this place is awesome. While Ron and the boys are hopefully getting lucky at the Rose Bowl, we have a massive project going on here at the shop, the photo booth. I had my guys strip it down to the show. But before we go any further on this thing, I thought I'd bring someone in here who could tell me exactly what we need to pull this job off.
Oh, wow. Rick called me in here to see how we can potentially get this photo booth running again and restore it back to its original operation. And this is astounding. This is basically the holy grail of photo booths. If you have this, you're
the bomb.
You're the bomb. So how this would work, there would have been a camera in here. It would have used a direct positive paper, black and white paper. Okay. And it would have had all kinds of rollers and gears and contraptions, relays that went through processes of chemistry, okay, and then spit that photo back out. It was a whole little mini dark room in this thing.
Right.
And we just got done with the body work. We haven't primed it yet, so it's basically ready. If we can get the original parts, we can get in there. So what do you got over here? This is all the stuff that came in it, some of the wiring. So what you see basically is all I have. Well, this is all great. Only one big problem. We're missing the camera and all the other parts. finding it is going to be next to impossible.
Strength tester, man. This is pretty awesome. Your dad loves these.
Yeah, strength tester, where you pull up on that.
That's frozen, man. How low do you think you're gonna go?
300.
If it were a later model, you might find some parts.
So what are we gonna do?
Because this is such a rare model, to bring it back to life, we're gonna probably have to convert to digital.
It sounds like it's just not gonna work out like a plan.
Well, this is all great. Only one big problem. We're missing the camera and all the other parts. Finding it is going to be next to impossible.
We're working on restoring an old mutoscope photo booth, and our expert Anthony is telling me there's no way we're going to find the parts that we need for this thing anywhere.
It's a technology that just is extinct. If it were a later model, you might find some parts.
So what are we going
to
do?
Because those parts are so rare, and this is such a rare model, to bring it back to life, we're going to probably have to convert to digital.
Okay, but is that something you can help me with?
It's gonna be a chore. It's gonna be hard. But yeah, we can certainly help you.
I told the customers that I'd get this thing working just like it did back in the day. But because we don't have all the parts we need, it sounds like it's just not gonna work out like I planned. But at least Anthony's here to help us repurpose this thing, because who knows what the hell it's gonna take. A camera, a computer, I don't know.
Unfortunately, I don't think we're gonna have a printer that's gonna fit in that little space.
Wow.
And that leaves us a little problem is with getting that photo out of that little chute. The smallest print size is gonna be 4 inches, one of the printers that we're using.
So what you're saying is now the new picture is basically twice as big as the old picture.
That's correct.
Right?
So some modification of this is going to be required for us to be able to get that photo out.
All right.
Yeah, I'll do some programming and get some stuff drawn up for you, and we'll go from there.
Awesome, bud.
Awesome, man. Thanks.
Right. Thanks. I'll show you out. While Anthony draws up the plans for how we'll convert everything, I'll have to call the customers and make sure they're okay with us turning it into a digital photo booth.
We're here at the Rose Bowl. I can't tell you how awesome it is to walk around this place again. I haven't been out here in years.
How do you think Bradley's doing? I mean, do you think it was a good idea?
Well, he'll step it up. Hopefully. I mean, you know, the kid's gotta learn.
Hey, what do you think, sir? This is 9,000 restored. I mean, sometimes I would get their attention, they would listen, but sometimes it wouldn't. They would just blow me off.
Okay, thank you very much.
Hey, have a good one, buddy.
We've got a barber's chair. We've got a slot machine. We've got Coke machines. Hey, you, mister, you know what I mean.
Hey, T, right over here. Check this out.
Oh,
check it out.
That's cool.
Strength tester, man. This is pretty awesome. I know we've done a few of them. And, you know, it's a Mercury athletic scale, so your dad loves these. I mean, he absolutely loves them. Yeah, strength tester, you pull up on that. That's frozen, man.
What would something like this bring in?
They probably bring in around $3,500 now. $3,500, $4,000. Okay, well, will you do me a favor and go find whoever owns the booth and let's talk?
Perfect.
On this, it's a great item. I don't want to just pass it by, yet I don't want to waste money on something that we can't restore.
I mean, this handle could cost $3,500 alone.
Hi. Hi.
How are you?
Fine, thanks.
We're interested in this.
Okay.
Okay, but this is a big issue.
This is like not doing
anything.
Not that he's really strong. I guess my question is 350 firm?
No.
Okay. How low do you think you would go?
300.
The most I would ever give for this is $100.
Yeah.
The most.
The best I could do is 250. That's it.
Okay. Well, sorry we couldn't make a deal.
All right.
But thanks.
Thank you so much.
We couldn't make a deal on the strength tester, but that's okay. I'd rather push it away and not get it than go back and have my brother's foot straight out my butt again.
What's up?
What are you doing?
Still sitting here.
I mean, I didn't make any sales, but I sat here for a good 3 hours
trying to sell these machines. This economy, people, you know, it's a little bit harder than 30 years ago.
Man, the Rose Bowl's changed in the past 30 years. All right, boys, let's pack it up. Hopefully, Rick isn't expecting the mother load like we used to pull in when we would come here.
On a mutoscope photo booth from the 1930s. And after meeting with our photo expert, Anthony, it looks like we're going to have to convert this thing to use a digital camera and printer. I went ahead and called the customer and got the green light on converting it. And now Dave's meeting with Anthony to go over the details on how to make it work.
I got a panel over here for you.
Okay.
So we can mount electronics.
You can use my camera.
Thanks.
Perfect. That's a nice little mount, Dave. So this camera box mounts into that bracket. So you've got a little spacer here so the camera can go up and down. We can tighten it. We can move it left to right for center placement.
Right.
And so there's no interference with the back of the door. We're clear with whatever's going to happen down here with the printer, because the printer's definitely
an issue.
Definitely an issue, yeah.
Man, I really hope all the modifications we made to this is enough to make this printer fit. Otherwise, I'm screwed.
All right, so here's our printer. You're at about, without the wires, at 10.5.
All right, you're close.
We're close.
Well, it looks like the printer's just barely going to fit inside, so that's a huge relief. But we still got to figure out how to modify this faceplate in order for the pictures to be able to come out. Man, what did Rick get me into?
Like the Rose Bowl?
Yeah.
It was cool, but I thought there was going to be more stuff.
And we didn't sell anything.
Well, I'll tell you what. Don't fear, because I've got a plan.
Rick doesn't let me travel out to California a lot for pics, because he thinks with the gas money alone, it won't be worth it.
But I've been dying to hit up this place that's just outside of L.A. that I know is going to turn this trip into a success.
Hi, guys. What can I do for you?
You Chris?
I am.
Chris. Hey, my name's Owen. I heard that this was the place to be for vending machines.
Yeah, let me show you what I got back here.
I started collecting coin-operated machines since I was 16 years old.
Cool.
These two doors open, and it was like seeing gold. I mean, I got instantly so excited. It was like being in a dream.
Is this more what you were looking for?
Yeah.
I want to go in there.
Go on in there and dig around what you need.
Dude. Look at the Pepsi watching!
This guy has world crown sliders, some candy machines, gas pumps, Coke chests. Holy crap. Awesome, awesome stuff.
Embossed. 7-Up, dude. We got to get this.
Bring it up. Yeah, look at it. Wow. Tyler going hard.
Dude, Dr. Pepper embossed.
I don't think I've seen more than one or two of these.
Anything in here you're interested in?
Yeah, all these pieces here, the two candies.
Okay.
And then 3 pumps.
I'm looking right around $5,000 for all of that.
I was honestly thinking $2,500 range.
$25?
Yeah, it's a package deal. We love to, you know, group it together, get all off your hands at one time.
I understand.
Can we do 45?
It's killing me. I could probably 38, and that's about as much money as I can let go.
I've had him a long time. I think it's time to let him go. So 38 will work.
You got a deal?
Yeah, very good.
Thanks a lot. I think it's a great deal. I think Rick's going to be really happy.
When marking a project that's painted or needs a decal, I often use a grease pencil. Sometimes I make too many marks that aren't needed. So what's the best way of removing those marks without damaging the paint job? A dry cloth. B, water. C, glass cleaner. D, oil from your forehead. The answer and more coming up. When marking an item that's already painted or applying a decal, I often use a grease pencil. Sometimes my marks aren't accurate and I need to redo them. So what's the best way of removing those marks without damaging the paint job? The correct answer is D, oil from your forehead. Basically, the oil from your skin acts as an eraser. Here, let me show you how. So these are the marks here that are the outside of the decal. I no longer need these inside here. So I'm gonna take them off. As you can see, it'll wipe your marks clear off the project. Using a towel and water will do nothing but smear your project, leaving a huge mess.
Hey! Boy, you're gonna go out with me all the time now.
You're back! How'd it go?
Good.
Did you have fun?
Oh, yeah. Had a ton of fun.
So, what'd you buy?
This?
An old dump truck.
Yeah, it looks really cool. It's old Murray dump truck. It's cool.
So, what else did you get?
This is the Rose Bowl.
Yeah,
That was it? That's all you got was that? Did you make some sales at least?
No, I was out there trying to sell for 3-4 hours. It was hard.
I don't get it. And the amount of money that three guys cost and all the gas to get down to California and back doesn't equate to any kind of a profit whatsoever. I'm going to lose money on that. So that was a wasted trip, waste of money, bottom line.
Hold on. Before you blow a gasket, I got a surprise, all right? Got to show you something. I've been trying to convince Rick to let me go check out this spot for weeks now. So this is my chance to rub it in his face.
Whoa! How many machines you get?
7 total.
Really?
Yeah, we got sliders, candy machines, gas pumps.
At that one place?
The one place.
That I told you not to go to?
Mm-hmm. I ended up at $3,800 for everything.
I normally don't like Ron going on long trips unless it's a sure thing. But I guess his hunch on this one paid off. When I saw that door open, I just saw tons of machines. I was stoked. $3,800 for 7 machines? These pieces are really hard to find, so that's a really good deal. This is incredible. I mean, this makes it all worthwhile for you to go down there. You did good. You did fantastic. You really did.
Right.
Good job.
Good job, boys.
Hey, these are the people at the photo booth.
Hey.
Hi.
We're here today at Rick's restoration to pick up the photo booth he's been restoring for us. And I just really can't wait to see what Rick's done to it.
You remember how this thing used to look?
Oh, yeah.
I remember.
It was a mess.
It's all rusty. Yeah.
It's all rusty and ugly. So you got all that envisioned there?
Oh, yeah.
All right. Ready?
Yeah.
Ready.
One, two, three.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God. It's beautiful. Look at the pictures. I just
picked
all the guys who work here.
Wow. Rick, this is unbelievable.
Oh, it's so gorgeous.
Holy crap. It's just blown away. It is gorgeous.
I cannot believe how different it looked. Oh, my God.
I mean, Rick, the paint job, the color, it's unbelievable.
It's beautiful.
I mean, even the details that you were able to do here, the signs.
Yeah, the logo perfectly. Yeah, yeah. It's beautiful.
It is pretty. Wow. And the top
didn't have that.
Didn't have it at all.
That is really neat.
Right. Ted must have made that piece up there. Check it out.
Cool.
That's awesome.
Cool, huh? I know we put some more family pictures up there, but you can take them out and put your own pictures in there.
Rick, it looks it's like a piece of art. It's absolutely beautiful.
Well, you're just seeing the outside. Let's come over here. So you ready to see the inside?
Yeah, open it up.
Go ahead.
That is so cool.
Wow. Unbelievable.
My biggest problem was to make it work, you know? We had to find an expert, and so we had to convert it over to digital. The original Coimex in there, and actually, when the slide bar comes back, it hits a micro switch that allows it to click, and then all the lights come on, and it's Hollywood time.
That's amazing. What Rick did to restore this photo booth is far beyond what I ever imagined it would turn into. It's absolutely stunning.
Okay,
it was so cool sitting in the booth and watching the lights go on and off and then waiting for the picture to spit out. Look at that.
Oh, wow.
It was a lot of fun, and it's going to be a blast in the studio.
It is so cool.
Isn't that fun?
It's awesome.
It's really fun.
Thank you so much.
You bet.
Thank you.
Thanks for letting me be part.
Thank you.
You bet. Let's go in the office. We'll finish out the paperwork. All right?
Okay.
All right. Awesome.
I guess that was kind of fun.
Up next on American Restoration.
What is that?
It's a Harley Davidson golf cart.
It's a Harley?
Wow.
Is she around?
Nope.
This should be mounted, but it's bouncing around. It's a... Holy crap.
Wow, that is pretty wild looking.
I've never seen one of these.
Ever.
It's a horse carriage cart. Well, if you think you're better, and he thinks he's better, you guys should just make a little bet.
I like that.
Ron is always trying to show off when it comes to sports, but there's no way he's beaten me in a round of golf. Oh, holy crushed. Look at a man's workbench. You see his passions. His work's in progress. The things that drive him crazy. Projects that? You get the point. Anyway, every workbench tells a story. And this is ours. American Restoration.
Check that out.
I love when stuff comes into the shop and it's not exactly what it appears to be at first sight. It's those little surprises that make my job so interesting every single day.
What is that? It's a 1973 Harley Davidson golf cart.
Can we take it off?
Yeah.
Can we
check it out?
Yeah.
I actually got the golf cart through a series of trades I did online. It's in pretty rough shape, but I know it's got a lot of potential.
Wow.
I have never seen a Harley-Davidson golf cart. I know that they were the very first ones to make gas-powered golf carts.
Oh, okay.
In the early 60s, here you already got these gas-powered motorcycles. Well, they started putting gas motors in golf carts, and they had three wheels instead of four wheels. Well, in the 70s, they started coming up with these four-wheel carts. In 82, they stopped making golf carts.
Yeah.
So this was pretty cool. They don't even have anything from that era. Is this battery or gas?
No, this is battery.
Wow, that's cool. This motor right here, the electric motor is actually what drives the whole machine. Weight distribution is huge. I mean, these batteries are heavy. They set them in a configuration that is weight perfect for the car.
She run?
Nope. All these batteries are in series. It could be one little wire off, and that's it. It wouldn't work, you know? Okay. See how this is bobbling around in here?
Yeah.
This should be mounted, but it's bouncing around. It's a batteries are still good?
I see that.
This golf cart almost took me for a ride, but the good news is she's still got power. So you have any kind of an idea what you want to do?
My plan is to get it restored and then put it up for auction so that 100% of the proceeds go to the Humane Society of the United States to fight future cases of animal cruelty.
Wow, that's awesome. That's a great cause. I love it. I want to see this thing to where it comes up to the auction and there's money flying out of pockets for this cause.
I want to be surprised.
We want to make it really cool.
Yeah.
I've got my work cut out for me. I can see that, though. The deal is this is all fiberglass, okay? So when you fix bodywork like this, you got to take and sand it all down, go below it, put resin on there, and put cloth on there, and strengthen it. So that's a little bit of a problem there. And then you used to have some kind of a top on it.
Yeah, I had a top.
Okay, we want to put it in auction. Somebody's going to go, I got to have that.
Yeah.
It's cute. We need to make it look bad.
Yeah.
To get all that done, I'm looking at about, $10,000.
Okay, well, you know what? It's for a great cause. I trust you. Let's do it.
All right, good. All right, let's go in the office. We'll take care of some paperwork.
I'm extremely excited about seeing what Rick's going to be able to do with this golf cart. I just hope that Rick can work his magic so that I can raise as much money as possible for the Humane Society of the United States.
Tyler.
Yeah.
I need you to get somebody to tear down the new Harley-Davidson golf cart we just got in.
Yeah, okay, I can have Kyle and Roy get on that.
You remember I was driving around a golf cart playing golf many, many years ago?
Yeah, and I was pretty good at it, yeah.
You were mediocre at best. I was pretty good, and I used to leave you in the dust.
Ron's always running his mouth about how he's the best at sports in the family. But the older he gets, the more level the playing field becomes. Look at you, you're out of shape. You guys should just make a little bet. Go to the golf course and have it out.
I like that.
Okay, I don't have a lot of time. You know, I'll play one hole. I only got time for one hole, okay? One-shot deal.
What's the wager?
I think that you're always wearing that, and you know he's always wearing this. I've never seen him in anything else. So whoever loses has to get dressed in that ridiculous old-time golf attire for a whole day. I mean, hats, the socks, and those ridiculous shirts, all the knickers. Full-on golf. I'm in. I'm in.
I don't want to have to wear it.
No big deal. He's totally not going to win.
Not a chance in hell.
Hey, Roy. What's going on? How's this thing doing?
Good, just finishing up the lock.
Looks good.
Yeah, I think she's all ready.
I had Roy take the lead on fixing up this old Northwestern peanut vendor for a customer. And now I just want to check it out before we ship it off.
You know, these are so cool because they hold a variety of things. I mean, Northwesterns would hold peanuts, they could hold gum, they could hold prizes. I remember coming up to these things and putting a penny in and getting a ring. Really cool. So the customer wanted this thing originally, just dented and beat up, like, you know, over the years. Well, the glass was there, so we cleaned all the glass up.
Sometimes they get all stained, so that looks great.
What I like is, you know, this polished out, you can see that the 1 cent was actually inlaid in the brass back underneath there, so it looks really cool.
Very nice.
And then the other thing was, this button was painted white.
Right.
So polished it out and ended up the red, which is what it should have been. It looks really good inside. This is the coin mech. This was actually a rejector that could be replaced. This is set up for a penny.
You should have seen what was inside. It was pretty gnarly.
Yeah.
Can I try it?
Yeah. You put the penny right in there, and then the nuts are going to come right out of there. You ready?
Come on. Gotcha. See, it works. Excellent.
All right, good job, Roy. We'll get it ready and we'll send it out.
Let's do it.
Hey, bud, how's it going?
Good.
Looks good. That looks really good. That's going to be nice.
Hey, how are you?
I'm Eric.
Hey, Eric.
I'm Rick.
How you doing?
Good to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
What's going on? You got something in there?
Yeah, I got a horse carriage cart.
Holy crap.
It's an old one.
Wow, that is pretty wild looking.
I came here today to drop off a horse pedal cart that I wanted to get restored.
And it's in pretty bad shape.
I've never seen one of these.
Ever.
I found it at a flea market about 10 years ago.
Really?
And when I brought it home, my mom saw it and she says, that's just like the one I had when I was little.
Oh.
It's definitely a pedal car.
And actually, when you pedaled it,
I think the horse gallops.
That's pretty cool.
Man, for as beat up as this thing is, I'm kind of digging it. I think I've heard of the brand name Traing before, but I'm definitely going to have to do some homework if I end up taking on this job.
If we do this, what are you going
to
do with it?
I just like to make it a family heirloom to sit in front of the fireplace, and when my grandkids come along, we have something to put them on and take pictures with.
Awesome. Awesome. All right, well, you can tell this thing's been ridden a lot, and it's been repaired. These little gobs of stuff on here are actually liquid metal. That's actually what's holding it together at the moment, but we'll go ahead and grind all that out.
What I found out in my research is there's a mane that's missing, and it looks like it's hair flowing, and it was metal. And it's missing the tail and the reins.
Oh, okay. Well, we'll have to figure out what that was, and we'll have to make it, and then we'll have to paint it. You know, and I don't even know what color it was, but I'll research and find out.
Okay, cool. So what are you thinking that's going to put me back?
I'm looking at probably $3,200 for the whole thing.
Wow. It's got to be done. It's a family heirloom now.
Awesome. Thank you very much.
It's very important for me to restore this because it was in my mom's past, and I want to make it in my family's future. And I'm real excited to see what Rick can do with this thing.
Have you ever been on a golf course?
Not once.
All right, well, it's your lucky day.
Why?
Teach about golf, teach about life. What's this?
Shake. Into the net. This isn't looking good for you. All right, you ready?
I'm ready.
All right, here we go. One, two, three.
Oh, my God.
Just started working on a Harley-Davidson golf cart that a customer brought in. He actually wants to auction it off in support of the Humane Society of the United States. So we really gotta make sure that this thing will sell for a lot of money. Meanwhile, I got Johnny, our toy expert, coming by to check out the horse pedal car that we're restoring and hopefully fill in some of the blanks that I have about this piece.
Oh, this is a neat piece, man.
Yeah. You know, this customer brought it in, and he wants to restore it, but there's a bunch of stuff that I need to know about it.
I don't know what colors. I don't know if it's complete. So I figured you'd give me a little history lesson.
Okay. It's all England, right?
Exactly. It's called, the name for it's the Trotting Machine. This is a Triumph toy company that made this, which was formerly known as Lyons Brothers. Lyons started off as wooden toys back in the 1850s.
Oh, really?
I mean, at that time, people were riding around with horses and stagecoaches and stuff like that, you know? So it was really, really popular up until, like, the 20s and 30s and started falling off. The car pedal cars were kind of taking over popularity-wise.
Right.
But this is definitely after World War II, I would say from the 50s. You see the welds here. You see a lot of other indicators. It says this is probably a later one.
Gotcha. He thought it had a mane. Did it have a mane?
It did. This is all pressed steel.
Yeah.
Same thing with the tail.
Now, you see how thick it was. So it's not one single piece of metal.
It would have been two. Yeah, molded.
Pressed steel.
Exactly. Yeah, it would have been molded. It would have been a molded mane.
And then the colors.
Definitely, they were known for using a lot of brighter colors. The ones that I've seen have been white,
red,
but they made a lot of these. So there would have been a ton of variations as far as the colors go coming out the factory. So what you pick, you wouldn't be hurting the piece at all. You know, but
you definitely got a project ahead of you, that's for sure.
Yeah.
But thanks
anytime,
very much.
Man.
I'll show you out. I was really glad that Johnny was able to tell me more about this thing. But if there's one thing I learned, it's that we got a lot of things to do to get this little horsey trotting again. While my guy's working on the horse pedal car, I'm meeting with my upholsterer, Charlie. I've got this Harley-Davidson golf cart, and I want to make this thing badass. I'm hoping Charlie can help me come up with an idea for a new top to bring this all together.
Hey, Charlie.
Hey, Rick. What's going on?
I got this golf cart in.
Here, I just got a picture of it.
It's a Harley-Davidson AMF.
Yep.
And
it needs a top.
Okay.
What do you think? I have an idea. I had a golf cart a couple years back. We made like a tea bucket type top where it came up in the back and had a freestanding over the front.
Right.
I can draw you a picture of it. Kind of an idea. It'll come out to the top like this, okay, and come down to the back, but we'll bend the poles, and then back in your back, we'll have it so it kind of arches, so the back will be open.
That wouldn't look bad. Are we going to have just square joints everywhere, or are we going to roll any of that?
We can roll the front.
I would like to roll the front. The back would look cool with that square shape. See how the back's square? Mm-hmm. But the front's got some kind of contour.
Yeah, it'll look really cool. If we have that round, it won't be so plain.
Right.
Right. Flat look.
Right.
I like it. Give us some character.
All right.
Thanks.
All right. Thank you very much.
Okay.
I'll see you later.
All right.
Good luck.
I'm pretty used to, Rick, just having seats for me to reupholster. So building the top for this golf cart is going to be a bit of a challenge, mainly because of the frame, because we're going to have to bend it from scratch ourselves. Once the frame is set, we'll cut several pieces of canvas, and then we'll clamp them from pole to pole and fit it until we have the T-pocket effect we're looking for. I think Rick's really going to like this. It's going to look good.
Why are you making me carry all the...
It's heavy.
That's what caddies do.
Ron and my dad recently made a bet about who's the better golfer, and I came with Ron today to just make sure he beats my dad.
Have you ever been on a golf course?
Not once.
All right, well, it's your lucky day.
Why?
Teach about golf, teach about life.
That sounds like a blast.
They kind of intertwine. Here's the deal with golf, dude. It's kind of like the way you treat a woman. If you're going to treat your woman with anger and no respect, watch what's going to happen to this ball.
Where'd it go?
Right. Okay?
All I saw was dirt.
She's going to leave, you don't know where she's going to go, and you're left with nothing but an empty hole, which that would be your heart. Now watch this.
Come up. Nice, gentle,
soft, flowing movement.
Oh, yeah, that's gone. Bye. Shake. Into the net. You were talking all that to my dad, and now you got to back it up, and this isn't looking good for you.
You know what? You think you can do it better?
Yeah.
All right.
To be honest, I've never played golf before, but it can't really be that hard.
All right, no, make sure you do it.
I don't need your advice. It's like caveman stuff, dude.
All right, put it down. Man, do I hope that Tyler takes after his dad in the way they play golf. If that's the case, it's in the bag, baby. You know Caddy's my lunch, too, right?
Eric's here for that.
Hey, Eric, how you been?
Good.
Good to see you.
Oh, I've been waiting for this.
I came here to pick up my horse pedal cart. When I dropped it off, Rick had never seen one of these before, and I really didn't have too much information. I'm really interested to see what he came up with.
All right, you ready?
I'm ready.
All right, here we go. One, two, three.
Oh, my God. That's awesome.
Check it out.
That's the same thing?
That is it.
Oh, my God. It's beautiful.
You even got the white tires, the rain, and the tail, and the everything. It's beautiful.
When Rick took the sheet off, I was blown away. It was so beautiful. I love the color. Everything you did to it's perfect.
Eric, this thing was a ton of work. I mean, this particular piece was done in the 50s, and it was called the Trotting Machine.
Trotting Machine?
Yeah.
That's a great name for it.
Yeah.
Very British.
Right. So, you know, over the years, I've worked on tons of pedal cars. I mean, all kinds of American stuff, and nothing have I ever done exactly like this, ever. And so we struggled with it from the body shop. The horse was so rusted, and this is actually welded together here and welded together here. And the mechanism's on the inside, so we had to split the horse. Each one of the legs were smashed in, so we had to open them up, pound them all, get them nice and straight again. And then on the mane, you know, it had a little slit right through here. So what we did is we took two pieces of metal and formed it and then welded it all back in here. And then, of course, on the tail, that's all done exactly like the mane. On the reins himself, I have a friend that does a lot of this kind of work for us. He handmade that. But, you know, this is basically the area to turn it. So it was stuck, but now it all turns the wheel.
That is awesome. Rick did a great job. I can't wait to get this horse pedal cart back and to surprise my family with it. It'll be a family heirloom from now on.
Often you'll hear professionals advise the use of tack welds on metal projects. Tack welding is basically a temporary weld allowing you to hold your two pieces of metal together. But why are tack welds so important? A, they temporarily hold welds together. B, they help maintain the alignment of welded pieces. C, they help prevent warping. D, all the above. The answer coming up next. Why are tack welds so important? The correct answer is D, all of the above. Here I have two pieces of metal that I need to weld in order to make a basic right angle joint. I got them secured with C-clamps, and I'm gonna make two short welds on each end of the C. Now I'm gonna repeat the process on the other side. Even though the tack welds are the initial part of the process, they have to be sound because they're the foundation of the entire joint. While Ted's busy doing up the Harley-Davidson golf cart with a custom paint job, I'm out at the golf course to settle this little bet that I have with Ron.
Look who decided to show up.
How long you been here?
Not that long. I just got here.
Yeah, sure you did.
My Uncle Ron and my dad made a bet about who would have to spend the day wearing ridiculous golf clothes around the shop. And since I'd love to see my dad dressed up, I've got my money on Ron. Oh, holy Christ.
Not that I need it, but I stopped off and got something just to throw him off his game. Come on, bro. Blow us away. Holy smokes! It disintegrated!
What was that all about? An exploding ball? Really? You two got some serious issues. I mean, you know.
I didn't put the ball down.
Yeah, well, I know you put him up to it. This one ain't gonna explode, right? It's a real ball.
That actually wasn't bad, my brother. You know, Rick might have an off chance that he's good for one day in his life, but probably not.
Oh, God, where are you?
Right.
I think it's on the green.
Unbelievable.
Oh, that's good.
That's going in. That's in the hole. That's freaking in the hole.
Oh! At this point, we're tied going onto the green, so I feel pretty confident.
Oh, you just lost your advantage.
Now it's Ron's turn, man. As long as he sinks his putt, it's my dad in golf shorts.
Hopefully you got your size knickers.
Oh!
Wait! A blindside!
Not even looking! Unbelievable!
I didn't even have to look. I stared him dead in the eye and sunk the putt. Winner! I'm not gonna let my brother live this down for a long time.
I gotta get back to work!
I need cocktails, I just won!
Come on!
That's not Rick around here
somewhere. But you excited?
Oh my God.
I can't wait.
Rick!
I'm here at Rick's to pick up my 1973 Harley Davidson golf cart. I wanted to get this restored so I could put it into an auction and have all the proceeds go to the Humane Society of the United States.
Rick!
All right, you might be all cruising around. I'll take it for a test spin. Here we go.
Holy cow. Oh, yeah. Wow. That thing's awesome. Oh, this thing's insane.
Check it out.
Wow. That thing's amazing.
I'm out. Thanks, you love it. And you, where's your tire? A bet's a bet, fool.
Anyways, what do you think?
You like it? This is crazy. I'm excited, but I'm honestly getting emotional. You know, my hands are shaking, honestly. I'm extremely excited. When I dropped it off, it was really just a shell of a golf cart. Rick was able to take what looked early 70s and turn it into something that's just badass Harley. This screams Harley Davidson.
Yeah.
It didn't have a roof on it.
No. Charlie's my upholster.
You know, we basically had nothing to go off except those four pieces in the back that held it were there still. And I wanted to make it look cool, but I still wanted to make it look like it was the era, too. You know, 1970s. Yeah. There's a lot of work on this. All the fiberglass, you remember, was stressed and was cracked. So we have to end up redoing all the body work on it.
Here, you want to check under the hood?
Absolutely.
Here we go.
Wow.
You remember what it looked like back there?
We chromed all the hinges. Everything's been chromed in there. All new batteries on it. All the solenoids and everything have all been gone through. And it cooks. It would be a cool ride on the golf course. Can I drive it? Oh, yeah.
Take away.
When I sat down and I was able to turn the key and hit the gas pedal, I mean, it's amazing. It's soft. It's smooth. Woo! I feel like this is going to go a long way towards rescuing and saving some animals.
Pretty quick, huh?
Oh, that's fun. That is awesome. You have no idea how much this is going to help the cause. I can't thank you enough. I can't.
All right, man.
You got it.
Let's go in the office and we'll finish up paperwork and I'll help you load that.
Okay. I can't stop looking at it. All right, Kyle. I want to take these pipes and get them down to Chrome ASAP. All right?
Looking stylish,
oh
baby.
Oh, my God. You look great.
You said you were going to go put it on. I didn't think you were going to.
That's a bet.
It's a little bit wrinkled. You want to hit that with an iron?
Up next on American Restoration. What is this?
Cutting edge technology, 1920s. And a little piece of bad news.
The bodywork is just outstanding to me.
Every month, Kelly holds a car show here at the shop. Just a whole lot of fun.
I want you guys to find the baddest stuff.
I'll be the judge of the best car that came in.
You got the bell, you got the batteries, the electrical and that. Look at these. It's like four different projects.
Yeah, there's a lot of parts. It's gonna take forever.
Look at a man's workbench. You see his passions. His work's in progress. The things that drive him crazy. Projects that? You get the point. Anyway, every workbench tells a story. And this is ours. American Restoration.
If I had to make a list of my all-time favorite customers, Mark from the Ely Train Museum would be one of the first people that comes to mind. Every time he rolls in here, he brings me something I never dreamed I'd be working on.
Looks like railroad.
Rick, how are you?
How you been, Mark?
Excellent.
What is this?
We have just a little project for you. The Nevada Northern Railway is a National Historic Landmark in Ely, Nevada. We have 56 acres, 70 buildings and structures. We have the original steam locomotives, diesel locomotives. I'm here at Rick's Restoration to have Rick and his crew restore a pair of wigwag signals for the museum up in Ely.
What is all this stuff?
Well, what you're holding is what's called a flag or a wigwag. See, this is cutting-edge technology 1920s.
Cutting edge, yes.
In the past, at railroad crossings, they had a flagman, and the flagman had a red lantern. So every time a train came by, flagman would step out and go like this.
Okay.
It got very expensive.
Right.
This was the technological fix.
This is basically the flag, then.
That is the flag.
Going back and forth.
Yes, it's called an auto flag. So we have the two signals, the control box, one bell, and a little piece of bad news. We're missing both flags.
What about that one?
I'm borrowing that to...
This is where we're looking at.
You're looking at, yes.
So they're that hard to find?
Yes, very hard to find. The owner of it says if I don't bring it back, she'll kill me. I mean,
it's definitely going to be a challenge to build two of these things from scratch, but at least we have one on hand to use as a template. So how do the trains activate the wigwags?
As the train goes through, the metal wheels of the locomotive creates an electric short, sends a signal to the box triggers the signals, train goes past on the other side, short's removed.
So it's an on and off switch, basically.
Correct.
On and off.
Yes.
Wow, that's amazing.
Inside here, we got to totally restore that, make it wired. On the top, does it have the cross?
I have pictures.
Of what they should look like?
Yes.
Oh, cool. The railroad crossing signs are gone, both of them. So we'll go through this. This exterior, it's probably the easiest part. We'll rewire the whole inside, make it look really, really nice. Get these poles out, get them all sandblasted and everything. Go through the wagger motor on the top, paint them all up. Hopefully find the parts and get you this thing. So make sure these guys don't get ran over by a train.
What are you thinking it's going to cost to get this all restored back to operating condition? Be gentle.
Eight. So I'm looking probably about 18 to 20 grand.
Okay.
I'm excited about this.
This is great.
Some of the stuff you bring in is fun. The stuff you don't even get to work on, you know? You good?
I'm good.
All right.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Thank you very much. We're going to install them on one of our main tracks, and every train leaving the museum will go past those signals and trigger them. The museum is paying for it with donations from our members, specifically to get these crossings installed and working. He has got to get them to work.
Hey. Ty, you got a man?
What's up?
Have a seat. We got a little family meeting.
Okay? Family meeting.
Uh-oh.
Yay.
What do we do now? Every month, Kelly holds a car show here at the shop so people from all over the city can show off their rides. It brings the community together, it helps promote the business, and it's just a whole lot of fun. But I really want to get the guys more involved in the event, so Kelly had an idea for a little contest that should be right up their alley.
Okay, so you know how I do the car show every first Friday of the month, right?
Yeah.
And it's been getting bigger and bigger every month.
Yeah.
We've had some really good stuff.
Yeah.
I want you guys to find the baddest stuff, okay?
Like as a competition.
As a competition?
Right.
You guys got to go out throughout the neighborhoods and the car shows and everything out in town, and he who finds the best car basically wins. I'll be the judge of the best car that came
so
in.
So you know what we need to do? We need to find the car that he will like the most.
No, yeah. These guys are already trying to rig the
competition.
We're not
trying to rig it. We're trying to make it fair.
Just bring in the baddest car.
So what do we get?
Week off?
A week off.
Oh, my God. A week off?
With pay.
And I'd rather be a surprise. I want you to go out and work for it.
How do we know it's good, then?
Because I'm not as cheap as he is, so.
True that.
Okay? True that.
Oh, my God.
Sorry, babe. Make me proud, because this is my deal. Remember that, okay?
You got it. Absolutely. I have no idea what these clowns are going to find, but they better not let Kelly down. You do not want to be on Kelly's bad side. So what do you think of this big, huge bucket of bolts?
There are all sorts of stuff going on.
Yeah. We're restoring a wig-wag train signal for the Ely Museum. And Kyle and I have to figure out how this thing works before we can start tearing into it. This thing is actually the control box for these two signs. These used to go ding, 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 and let you not run over the railroad tracks. It actually has a switching system that after it comes out of this control box, this tells the wagger to wag.
Okay, so the wagger's right here. Let's go with that.
Yes, right here. Going like this.
Okay.
Because they were all over the country, out in the middle of nowhere, there was no power there. The only thing they ran off was these batteries.
No power.
No power at all. So, you know, it was very redundant. So when this one went out, it would go to this one, and this one would go out and go to this one. They wanted to make sure they had backup.
Nice.
Okay, so if you run into any problems, just come get me and we'll figure it out. All right?
All right.
A lot. That's a good looking piece.
Isn't it? I'm working on a bike restoration that needed some special parts. So I asked my friend Danny from Counts Customs to come by and check them out.
What's up, guys?
Hey,
what's
up, man? My guy for the car show's here. You guys got a minute? What do you got going on?
And we gave Brett Lee, Tyler, and Ron the opportunity to go out throughout the town and try to find the best cars from the car show.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, so you want to check it out?
Let's twist my arm.
All right, let's go.
Sweet.
Rick and I both love pickup trucks, so I stuck with what I know and found a guy with the custom Apache that just blew me away when I saw it.
This is the winner?
Boom.
Oh, dude, that's a good looking truck.
Thanks for coming down, man.
Hey, bro. What's your name?
Danny.
Danny, nice to meet you. I didn't remember that. How you been?
Good to meet you.
Beautiful, man. What a good looking ride.
Thank you. I'm reading a 1958 Chevy Apache truck, step side, small window. Special about this truck is that it was my dad's, and it brought our family really close together when my dad got sick. We went ahead and took it in, all my brothers, and we just built it from the ground up.
How many years did it take to restore this truck?
Took us 5 years.
5 years?
Yeah. We started it, and then my dad got sick. We took a little break to attend to him, and then we got back on it and got it finished up.
How's your dad?
He passed away.
I'm sorry.
God bless you, brother.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's a beautiful tribute to him, bro. I love the old school swamp cooler. Nice touch.
A lot of original accessories on there.
The bodywork is just outstanding to me. What do you run for a motor in it?
We got a 350 Chevy with a 350 automatic.
Ah, man, look at that.
Friendly, why don't you go ahead and fire it up?
All right, man. See that?
A winner gets to fire his truck up.
You may have found a winner here, bro.
That's right.
I'm serious.
Woo! Yeah!
Yeah!
looks good.
You smell that? It smells like Victory.
It does smell like Victory.
Yeah. Bradley really scored big with this Chevy truck. Ron and Tyler are really going to have to step it up if they want to win, because there's no prize for second place.
So you ready?
I'm ready.
All right.
Oh, my God. This is better than my imagination. And I have a vivid imagination.
From the Ely Train Museum brought in a 1920s wigwag train signal to be restored. There's a lot of complicated parts in the motor and the electrical system, so I called in the cavalry to help me figure this thing out.
Thank you very much for coming.
Oh, my pleasure. I'm the owner of railroadstuff.com, and I specialize in antique railroad signal restoration.
Our customer at Nevada Northern Railway has a portion of his property that tracks go across, so he wants to be able to stop the traffic safely with these signals. Okay, so basically what we need is to know, how do I make those work?
Well, basically what it is, it's an electromagnetic pendulum. You get a slow start of these magnetic fields interacting with each other, and then it builds up momentum until your banner is swinging from side to side, and then it just rock and rolls.
Gotcha.
The main issue is to make sure all your coils work.
Okay.
You know, and once you know that, you can strip everything down, get it all put in there, and rewire it from the schematic, and you'll be happy.
So these things here, I think we got figured out.
Thanks very much.
My pleasure.
I searched all over Vegas, and I found a sure thing for this car show contest. My dad loves to keep things all original, and I know he has a thing for old Buicks, so I got this win locked up.
Jay, come on! Oh, my God.
That's pretty.
Look at that.
I own a 1956 Buick Estate Wagon.
Hey, nice. How you been, Jerry?
Hi, okay.
Good. This is my dad, Rick.
Beautiful car.
Thank you so much, sir.
I love the color. This is a very low production car.
And it's what's called a factory 3-speed on the column.
Yeah, so that made it even rare.
Yeah, maybe only 3,000 were built.
Wow, so this is a real rare car.
Yeah, 95% of these parts came with a car. They don't reproduce anything for it. So if you don't have it,
you're done.
You don't get to have it.
Car collectors would kill for a piece like this. With only 3,000 made and 95% original parts, it's a rare gem, especially in this condition. When I was a kid, my parents had Buicks. That's all they ever got. And I remember tapping on the dash, doing all these crazy things as a kid. The whole family in the car. The St. Bernards were in the back. Slobbering all the windows, and the kids are all over the place.
See, I knew you'd like it.
I love the grill. I mean, I love the bumper. Everything about this car is heavy duty.
Character.
Oh, wow. Holy smoke. Man, that is just as stock and as perfect as you can get. Oh, my God. The windshield washer. The battery's right. Everything in this is just exactly
as close as I get it to original.
Yeah.
That was the plan.
So what do you think, Dad? Did good, huh? I don't know who's going to be the winner yet, but this has definitely brought back a ton of memories, and it's absolutely gorgeous car. Thanks for bringing it in, Jerry.
Thank you so much.
Tyler made a great choice with this Buick. I love the original restoration. It's my favorite color, and it brought back great childhood memories. This competition is definitely heating up. It's going to be one heck of a car show. The guys have been making some good progress on this big wigwag project. The control box needed some repair welding. Kyle's been going through all the electrical systems for the signals and the bell. We've been polishing up all the parts so they look like they're factory new again. But one of the trickiest parts of this project is remaking the two wigwag banners from scratch. I did some research and found the correct style and dimensions that we needed. So now Dave's going to refabricate the entire thing down to the last detail. Luckily, the plasma cutter is really good at cutting out all the circular patterns that we need to fabricate it out of sheet metal. Once Dave's done with the fab work, we'll paint them up, mount them on poles, and we'll have a pair of wigwags that look exactly like the originals.
That's 6-1 Bob.
Yep.
Legendary, right?
Like easy.
Legendary.
Rick usually deals with classic car restorations, so I really wanted to push the envelope with a car that's so tricked out that his jaw is going to hit the ground when he sees it.
Wow.
Just insane.
That's a paint job. That's pretty.
Marty, Rick.
Marty.
Nice to meet you,
bud.
I picked a 6-4 Impala. The main reason is because it's a 6-4 Impala. It's legendary. Rapper sung about it. The Beach Boys sung about it. And this thing is cherry.
Wow, this is sweet.
Super sport, bro.
Hard to find.
Wow.
So did you restore it?
Yeah, it was pretty much bone stock. We totally tore this car down. Repainted, chromed everything underneath twice.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
And I decided one day I had a little more power, so I put a 350 in there, dressed it up, chromed it.
Oh, booyah. God, it's just beautiful on the inside. There's nothing on this you can get in chrome or polish. It's beautiful.
My favorite feature on the car is the custom paint. I always like blue.
Paint job on it is just flawless.
tape shades, patterns. There's murals that are ghost murals on the paint.
There's a ton of work.
A lot of work and a lot of credit card bills.
Yeah. Man, you get up close to this car and there's just like, wow.
It gets better the closer you get, dude.
I like this, dude.
I love that. That was hilarious. How's your trigger doing? Dude, it moves the entire car.
Oh, my God. This thing, I'm assuming, is what gets the car up. It hydraulically lifts the back end of the car, front end of the car.
It literally goes up, down, and the side.
Down, and actually, three-wheel.
That's cool.
In case you need to change your tire on the road.
Don't need a jack, do you?
No.
This is legit.
Thanks for bringing it over.
Oh, thank you.
Thanks, Marty.
Yeah.
Good job, Ron.
I know this Impala is totally out of Rick's comfort zone, but I definitely think I'm winning this contest. I found a totally unique car, and I didn't kiss his ass like those plug-tube dipsticks. Dude, that's awesome. He never tells me good job. Thanks, dude.
To cut metal precisely, we often use a plasma cutter, which uses electricity to superheat gas and allows us to cut metal like butter. When using a plasma cutter, what is a good indication that you're moving the torch too fast along the material? A loud buzzing noise comes from the cut. B, molten metal accumulates along the bottom of the cut. C, sparks fly from the top of the cut back at you. D, sparks fly through the material towards the ground. The answer and more coming up next. When using a plasma cutter, what is a good indication that you're moving the torch too fast along the material? The correct answer is C. Sparks will fly from the material back at you. This is the right way to do it. And you'll notice that the sparks don't fly back at you. As you can see, it's a nice, clean, precise cut. I'm using a straight edge in order to get a nice, clean line. I moved slow enough to be able to make the cut and not to get bit with a bunch of sparks.
Can you get by enough there, big guy?
The wigwag crossing signal for the Nevada Northern Railway Museum is almost complete. Not only does it have to look great, but it also has to function in order to keep visitors from crossing the tracks when a train comes by.
At least 2 hours on one side and one on the other.
Mark is on his way. He's one of our most important clients, so we hope he's pleased with our work.
Rick.
Hey.
Mark's here.
Hey, Rick. Hey, Mark, how you been?
Great, great. Yourself?
Good. So good. You, what you here for?
The fulfillment of a 10-year dream. I'm here at Rick's today to pick up a set of very rare wigwag train crossing signals that Rick and his crew have restored for me. They have been sitting outside in the weather for 40 years. I saw them 10 years ago, and I thought, you know, I have to get those restored someday.
Okay, it's over here.
All right.
Over here. Why don't you stand right here?
All righty. Being able to see these back in perfect condition and them actually working will be just unbelievable. I'm ready to see it. Let's see it.
This is a bad boy. Here we go. One,
two, three. Oh, my God. Unbelievable.
Man.
Oh, my God. Unbelievable. God, it is absolutely beyond my wildest dreams. I am stunned. I basically dropped off scrap iron to Rick. And he turned this scrap iron into an art piece. I've been dreaming of this moment for a decade. And Rick, he didn't knock it out of the park. He knocked it out of the solar system.
It took every one of my guys. Dave refabricated that whole banner. It's totally hand-built. The pipe, the lenses on the front, the Western Railroad Supply logo on there. We polished that all out. So it popped. You know, we wanted to sort of look at it. And I decided to do the harps in black and then have these poles in white. These are reflective. It's just going to stand out like a sore thumb. This is where all the work takes place, is for these things working. If you remember, the inside of this thing was
a rat's nest?
Left alone for too many years. It was just, the wires were worn out, glass insulators around all the switches just destroyed. You want to see what it looks like on the inside?
Yes.
Here we go. There's the inside.
Oh, Rick.
We just went nuts. We just polished every button holes out. Man, it's all brass. I want to be able to see it. This thing here is something like I'd like to have on my desk.
Oh, I can see that. Yeah.
It's so cool. It's got a little handle here. You unwire it, pull it out. They fixed it. Boom, put it back in.
This is the brain of the signals. Yep. And if you don't have that, you don't have signals.
Nope.
All right. The $64,000 question.
Yeah.
Do they work?
Give me a second. Let me see if I can wire something up for you.
I've been waiting 10 years, Rick. 10 years. Let's see it.
All right, here we go.
Oh, my God. Utterly incredible. Every train leaving the East Daly Depot will
will be going past these signals, and these signals will once again do what their designers intended, protect the rail crossing.
So they're going to live again.
They're going to live again. And that's what we do.
I'm really happy.
Oh, God.
I'm glad I could be part of this. Let's go in the office. We'll finish the paperwork.
Okay, cool.
Get you on your way and figure out how we get that thing up to you.
You don't deliver?
It's the night of Kelly's car show. Bradley, Ron, and Tyler all got their cars back to the car show. And now I'm going to announce the winner.
6.4 Impala. Nothing on it.
That thing's cool, but this is all original.
Ron, look at all the chrome.
Chrome don't get you home.
Chrome envy. Chrome envy, baby.
Hey, all of you did a great job. These are awesome cars. And this was a really, really tough decision for me. But the winner is the 56 Buick.
Yes!
All the cars were beautiful, but the Buick brought up the most sentimental value to me, and that's the one I picked.
I'll accept my prize now.
What is a prize?
The winner gets one payday off.
Yeah, oh my God, it just keeps getting better. Not only did I win, but I get a payday off. Now I can rub it in Bradley and Ron's face for eternity.
All right, guys, awesome job, great deal. You know, let's go enjoy the car show.
Good job.
Good job.
That is a clean car, though.
Up next on American Restoration.
This is a scoreboard from the 1940s.
That's so cool.
Can you make it look good?
I can make it look good.
But can you make it work?
This is a uranium detector.
No way. Really?
Yeah.
It's detecting the radiation that it emits.
This goes all the way back to your physics thing that you failed.
I got a D. It wasn't failing.
You failed.
There's a lot of wires, and what I need you to do is label each one of them.
Whatever.
Cowboy, every single wire gets a label.
Wait till you see. I'm going to label everything.
Look at a man's workbench. You see his passions, his works in progress, the things that drive him crazy. Projects that? You get the point. Anyway, every workbench tells a story, and this is ours, American Restoration.
There's somebody here to see you. Okay, come on, bring it in.
Here at my shop, we can restore anything from any part of the world. But no matter how obscure an item is, if it's made in the USA, it's extra special to me.
What is this?
This is a scoreboard. It came out of a high school from the 1940s.
Can I open it?
Sure, go ahead. I'm here at Rick's Restorations today to drop off my scoreboard. I own the local bar. We used it when we shot pool, and I'd like to see it restored back to its original condition.
It is so awesome.
It's not baseball or football. It's definitely basketball.
Yes, that's a countdown clock.
Yep. That's the buzzer. You got quarters, first, second, third, and fourth.
I remember in our gym in high school, we had sort of something like this, right?
Yeah, similar.
Did you know the manufacturer on this or anything?
It's All-American.
Yeah, the guy that invented the All-American Scoreboard Company, he was actually a principal of a school. They wanted a scoreboard, an electric board, and he actually made it. Later on, he quit school, and he started making scoreboards.
Yep.
I mean, this was really cool to be able to have an electronic scoreboard, because before that, it would be nothing but the guy.
Yeah, it was just a big wood board, and these guys with numbers have to climb up there and be behind there and actually hang numbers or spin numbers in the back.
Yeah.
Back when this scoreboard was made, life revolved around your community, your school, and high school athletes were the hometown heroes. So to make the school feel special and fancy, they get a cool scoreboard just like this.
This is basically the controller that operates this entire face. Everything about it, resetting the clock, it would do these one of the numbers. It probably even blew the horn.
Push the number up here that you want, and then you change the score, you push the red button.
Yeah.
All right, so does it work, though?
Right now, I don't believe anything works.
Oh, I want to know what you want to do with it, though.
I want it to look good, and I want it to work.
Okay.
I like to hang it in my office. I have a combination office game room. I like to keep score on it.
Okay.
I was hoping maybe in the center, you could put a regular clock face in there. This is actually a picture of the original building it came from.
Oh, wow.
Maybe you could put like a ghost to that picture.
Okay. So what you're going to do is sort of inlay this background, or it looks like that. That'll look cool in there, actually.
Very cool.
All right, so we can go ahead and fix the clock. This will be a clock with 12 numbers instead of 8. It'll light, like you said, a ghost shadow of the school. We'll redo the hands, you know, whatever they were originally.
Right.
We want to make the buzzer buzz.
Yeah.
We'll replace all the bulbs.
I definitely like to have the original connectors.
Yeah, that's right, the original ends on it and everything.
So what do you think this will cost?
In order to do the whole thing and make it work again, make it pretty, I'm looking between $95 and $9,800.
Whoa.
Wire is very, very expensive.
It's copper?
You can run into, $1 to $5 a foot. And I can't see inside of this. If I have to replace every single piece of wire in there, we could get in trouble.
I'd love to see it working again, so let's do it.
All right.
All right.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Thank you.
This scoreboard is such an awesome piece of Americana. And the nice thing about these early electronics is they're fairly straightforward. I can't wait to get started.
And he shoots.
He scores.
I'm Rick.
Melissa.
What can I do for you?
I was cleaning out my father's garage, and I found something, and I wanted to restore it.
Oh, cool.
Well, let's bring it over here,
okay? My dad was a lover of gadgets, a lifelong educator, and I found something on his workbench. I wanted to restore it because it just really summed up what my dad was.
Wow. What is that?
This is a uranium detector.
No way. Really?
Yeah. I was cleaning out my father's garage, and I found it in a pile of junk. He was a gadget man, and...
Man after my own heart.
Yeah. He loved interesting devices.
That's pretty cool. These were around a lot, actually, in the 50s and 60s. This thing is so cool. I remember back when I was a kid, people used to use them to look for precious metals on their property. The government was building so many nuclear weapons, they'd actually pay you if you found some radioactive material. So many people were investing in these things.
All right.
Well, what do you want to do with this thing?
Well, I'd like it cleaned up. I'd like the glass repaired, the rust removed. I want it looking good. And in memory of my father, I would love to see it working.
Okay.
Restoring it, all the chroming, we can go ahead and just clean that, redoing the face of it. I think I can definitely make it look great, but I don't know if I'm going to be able to make it work. So I got to go inside of it
and see what's there.
I'm assuming it's electronic. But it may be tuned. I don't know, because it's another one of those pieces that I've never ever seen before. So I know there's an expert in this kind of stuff. He might be able to tell us, you know, what, how it worked.
Okay.
So I'll ask him whatever I got to do to make it happen. But if I can get the whole thing done, working, I'm looking at probably $1,500 to do the whole thing.
Ooh. Yeah. That is a lot for such a little old device. Well, this is the only thing I kept at my father's. And this will be a good tribute to him, so let's do it.
All right, that's awesome.
Thanks.
Thank you. Let's go in the office. We'll take care of a little paperwork.
Okay.
I'll get started.
$1,500 is a lot of money. For that price, I really hope you can get it working again.
I've never had to restore a uranium detector before, so in order to do this job right, I need some more information about it. So Tyler and I are heading to the National Atomic Testing Museum to speak to some experts.
How you doing?
I'm Rick.
Alan, director of the National Atomic Testing Museum.
Awesome.
And this is Karen.
Hi, Karen.
Karen. This is it right here.
Okay. It's something we need to restore, but I need to know a little bit more about it.
You came to the right place.
Awesome. Okay.
Let's go take a look.
All right.
The National Atomic Testing Museum is the keeper of the story of the nation's nuclear weapons testing programs, and particularly here in Nevada. So, Rick, here's Geiger counters.
All right, so, I mean, that piece of equipment there was a uranium detector, and then all these, I mean, you're calling them Geiger counters.
It's really the same kind of thing.
Yeah.
You're trying to detect radioactivity in materials, and a uranium detector does exactly that. It will find uranium because it's detecting the radiation that it emits.
This goes all the way back to your physics thing that I was trying to help you with.
Yeah.
It's great that you failed.
I got a D. I wasn't failing.
You failed.
So, Rick, let's go see how we use the Geiger counter.
Okay.
Being here reminds me a little bit of being back in school, but it never hurts to learn anything new because I never really know what we're going to get into the shop. I mean, any knowledge is helpful.
We've got a couple of samples here so we can kind of test this out, and I'll show you how it sounds.
Okay.
So every time you hear it beeping, it's picking up a particle. The more beeps you get, the more radiation is coming out of the material.
Wow. I think I know how to make the thing look beautiful, but I want it to work, and I don't know how to do that.
There are some components that are critical. There are circuit boards, there are batteries inside, and certainly the Geiger-Müller tube.
This thing here.
That tube is actually filled with an inert gas.
Did the gas leak out of these?
Well, it dissipates over time. You would have to send that out to a company to have it recharged.
Ah.
You got a lot of work to do.
You got a lot of work. So, okay, thank you very much. This is great. I never would have thought of sending out the GM tube for a recharge. So that alone made the trip well worth it.
When I saw there was that many wires and that much cable, I freaked out. I could see it taking me a long, long time to be able to do this.
It's time consuming.
It's really cool.
Can we see it work?
The only thing is I don't have any uranium.
Earlier, a customer brought in a really awesome scoreboard, just like the one from my high school days. But when Kyle and I took a closer look, we realized the cabling was corroded. It's so crispy when you move it.
Watch. That's trash.
And the wiring was a total mess.
We gotta replace it all.
I got so excited to restore the scoreboard from my high school days, I overestimated the condition that it's in. So I called in a heavy-duty wiring guy to sort this thing out.
I'm Jason. I specialize in electronic scoreboards. Hopefully, we can get the wire straightened out and we'll get it completed.
Oh, wow.
I called you because the cables and wires, all of them are all broke.
Gotcha.
They're not colored. They're not numbered. It's like, oh, my God. How are you going to get to know where this wire goes to this wire?
Actually, what I would do is just mark the back of this where these wires need to go really well and just hand me the cable.
Okay.
As long as everything's marked, we can get you a new extension cord.
So mark each one of these wires.
Correct.
I could see it taking me a long, long time to be able to do this.
It's time consuming.
So if I do all the wire labeling and cosmetic stuff, what's it going to cost me to get it up and running wire-wise?
About $10,000.
Quite honestly, I think it's better than sending it back to him broke. He wants it working.
Right.
So if you can do your end, I'll do my end. I think we can actually come together and figure it out, right?
Exactly.
All right. Okay, you got it. We'll do that.
$2,000 is more than I thought this wiring would cost. But I didn't think the wiring was going to be so complex. So having Jason do the heavy lifting is going to be money well spent. Since we got back from the Atomic Testing Museum, we've been going full tilt on this Geiger counter. We took it apart, fixed the casing, and now we're painting it. Meanwhile, my brother Ron has gone MIA, and that's never a good sign.
Cowboy, I got a job for you. What the deal is there's a scoreboard in the back. There's probably 100 wires. I need it all labeled. Okay, can you handle that?
That's a job for the boys.
I don't know why Rick's always got me doing these little jobs. They're a pain in the ass over there, leaving all them damn wires in that hot ass sun. Boys can hear that.
I really want it done right. If it's not labeled correctly, it's not gonna work at all, okay? Every single wire gets a label with like post-its or something.
Damn it. And you know how long it's gonna take me to label all them wires?
I know it's a tough job, but it's a really, really important one, and I need you to do it.
You say it's important, don't mean I gotta do it.
Cowboy, you're the guy. How come every time I give Cowboy a simple job, he has to give me crap about it? Why can't he just say, okay, Rick?
Can I have a beer at the same time?
Oh, you know dang good and well you can't have a beer, all right?
I'll label it, all right. It's hotter than a son of a out here. If Rick's gonna give me the world's worst job, I'm not gonna suffer it alone. Kyle owes me for a night out in the bar.
You got like 92 more.
Get this over with.
This is gonna take us all day.
You know I'm getting paid back for Rick for this.
The uranium detector is going to be done pretty soon. But if we're going to show them that it really works, we're going to need some uranium to test it on. Since they don't normally have any at the local hardware store, I called up the Atomic Test Museum to see if they could help me out. Now, I don't know what to expect, but I'm seeing glowing green rocks and a hazmat suit in my future.
How's it going? Hey, I'm Ron with Switch Restorations. I'm here to pick up a package.
Oh, yes. I think this is it for you, sir.
All right.
Now, if we could have you sign that for the two items we have in here, we have one Fiesta Ware teacup and one saucer.
Kitchenware? Seriously? Does stuff like glow when you turn lights off or anything?
No, what they did was they crushed up uranium and they used it for the orange glaze process. And it's what gives it the nice orange burnt color.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
This isn't radioactive or anything, is it?
Yes, slightly.
That's pretty crazy.
It's not going to top the charts on your radiation detector, but it will definitely give a signal.
Right on.
All right.
Have a good one.
You have a good day, sir.
Thanks.
Back at the shop, we're hard at work on the cosmetics for the 40 scoreboard. While we're bead blasting and buffing the light fixtures, Ted is using a pressure pot to make the lenses for the period lights on the scoreboard.
Flawless. Hey, Rick.
Rick.
Hey, Melissa's here for the uranium detector, dude.
Hey, Melissa.
I thought it was done. I can't wait to see this.
Yeah, you excited?
Yes,
this is pretty
yes.
cool. It came out really, really nice. I can't wait for you to
oh,
see it.
Great. When I dropped it off, it wasn't working, and you could tell it had sat around for a long time. But I'm really hoping it works and excited to see it.
Okay, Melissa, you remember what this looked like, right?
Yeah.
It had its own little character at the time.
Right.
You ready?
I'm ready.
All right, here we go. One, two, three.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, it is beautiful. Just like new. Glass and the bezel are fixed. To actually see it was just thrilling. I was really amazed at the appearance of the wand. That chrome looks perfect. It just looks great. So this must have been a bit of a job.
Oh, yeah. This is all aluminum.
Okay.
So we sandblasted that all. We actually handmade the plastic bezel on the front of it there.
Really?
And then we shot it with the same color that would have been back on it in the day. It's called Hammer Tone Aqua Blue. Silk screened all that art on there, so it looked just like it did back in the day.
Yeah. You did an amazing job. It is just beautiful. I was hoping that it would look like new, but I'm really concerned about whether or not it's working. I'm going to be disappointed if it's not. So can we test it? Can we see it work?
It does work, but the only thing is I don't have any uranium.
Well, that's not exactly true. Your little brother has a little surprise for you, all right?
What do you mean you got a surprise?
He doesn't know what uranium is. He has no clue.
I, too, made a trip to the National Atomic Testing Museum.
You did?
And I've had some uranium sitting around this place.
What are you doing with uranium sitting around the shop? I mean, really?
I don't know if I should have gloves, but...
It's a teacup
glazed with uranium.
That's pretty cool.
Is this okay to have sitting around my house?
Yeah. But don't drink out of it.
Yeah. All right, so pull this out. Okay, this is the wand. And what it does is this thing is going to read it. When you go over top of it, you're going to hold it down like that.
Oh, okay.
Okay, you ready?
Ready.
So watch the needle and you'll sort of hear it. Ready, here we go.
Oh, I hear it.
Yeah.
Oh, that is so
See?
Cool.
Can I try it?
Yes. Okay. Oh, there it goes. Oh, this is great. I've never seen it work, so to see the indicator move and to hear it clicking, that was really exciting.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Any project that I restore, I like taken completely apart, down to the bare bones, even if it's riveted. But removing rivets can often be a challenge. What is the best tool to remove small popped rivets? A, a drill. B, a hammer and chisel. C, an angle grinder. D, a punch. The answer and more coming up. What is the best tool to remove small popped rivets? The correct answer is A, a drill. To take a pop rivet off, you simply find a drill bit that's just a little bit bigger than the hole in the rivet's head. When you drill into it, all you want to do is drill the head of the rivet off. This allows the back of the rivet to fall off without affecting the original hole. Then when you want to reassemble your project, you can go ahead, use the same size rivet, and start putting it all back together again. With all the electrical now done on this 4D scoreboard, Kyle's putting it all together for the customer who's coming in later today to pick it up.
Hey, Rick.
Yeah?
Dale's here.
Oh, hey.
Hey, Rick.
Good to see you. Everything good?
I hope so.
You excited to see this thing?
I'm excited to see my scoreboard.
All right, well, it was a huge project for us, but I can't wait to show it to you. It's in here. Come on in here.
I'm really looking forward to seeing the scoreboard working again with all the lights working, and hopefully the buzzer's going to buzz.
You remember what this thing looked like, right?
It was bad.
A little disgusting, right?
I can't wait to see it, Rick.
Here we go. One, two, three.
Wow. Wow. The paint, everything on it is just so shiny. And I asked for it to look like it came out of the factory, and Rick, this does.
Rick really did an excellent job with it, and it's a perfect tribute to where the scoreboard actually came from.
This was a huge project. I mean, the wiring behind there's like 200 wires in here. The wiring thing was just a nightmare. I think I got probably 120 hours of just figuring out what wire went to where. In fact, I had to have an expert come in just to help me with just the cable itself. The rest of it, you know, the can itself, we went through, restored the can. Ted did all the artwork on here. It's all been cleared over.
Great.
It's brand new. The horn itself, we redid all this, powder coated this, make it all red. Of course, the face. Ted took your art off your postcard and transposed it onto this plastic to where it's actually, when you backlight it, you can see through it, so it looks really cool. We took and put a new clock in there that was capable of doing, you know, hours instead of like the eight minute clock. We kept the same hands and everything.
The clock, I just can't believe it. It's perfect. You nailed it.
Good.
Now, my next question, does it work?
Yeah. You ready? Watch the clock.
Okay.
It's gonna come on first. Here we go. One, two, three.
Wow.
See, it's lit up?
Yep.
All right, you ready for some more?
Let's see some other lights.
Okay, here we go. All right, so let's just pretend we're into the fourth period. Okay?
Wow.
All lit up. The score is 77-77.
Never seen that many lights on before.
And we're right at the end of the game. The clock's coming to the end. The buzzer's about to go.
It was great to see the numbers light up again. The period lights, the clock face. I mean, everything was great. And then when that horn went off, it just took me back to high school. I guess the final question is, where are we at with the budget?
You know, we ended up with quite a bit of time in it. But as far as what I told you before, we're on budget, okay?
I'm extremely happy.
You bet. Thank you, Dale, very much.
Thank you.
Well, let's go in the office. We'll finish up the paperwork, and then we'll get this loaded, okay?
Okay.
All right.
Sucks. I was having a label. Rick gave me this stupid job with all these crappy little labels, so I'm gonna label the out of his truck.
What the Cowboy!
Label 100, just like you wanted. Next time he'll be smart enough not to give me the crappy job.